fire exposures. I'm going to do a little vocabulary building here. And, you know, I'm sorry if it's a little wonky, but, you know, most of us have been thinking about direct flame contact, this idea that this like tsunami of flames is going to come at the building that we're in, and it's just going to overwhelm the building. And in reality, it can be that the fire is often a long distance away, maybe a mile or more away, and it's sending spots of burning vegetation or elements from other people's homes that are already engaged, and that material is being lofted at our home. And so you don't actually have direct flame contact, but you have these hot embers that are able to find a weakness or create a fire next to the home. So direct flame contact, embers, and now the next piece, radiant heat. Radiant heat is when you have an ignition of maybe your neighbor's building or your own garage that's detached, and the heat from that ignition creates enough heat to break a glass window, and then you get fire with inside the house. You know, it's kind of like putting your boots by the wood stove, and you know, it's sometimes if you put the socks there too, you can actually create ignition, right? So being aware of these three types of exposures are what we're going to talk a lot about, and you know, are really important for us to drill in. So coming back to embers, right? Embers are pervasive and they can get anywhere. They can find the nooks and crannies. My cabin was under evacuation as a result of the August fire. And when I came back, what did I discover? My cabin did survive, but underneath my door into the front of my house was a whole pile of ash. And so I realized that my weather stripping wasn't very good, and embers would have been able to get right inside my house if I had actually had not just ash, but embers. So embers find those weak spots. And what that means is that embers are often responsible for the majority of home ignitions, where in this case, it looks like from the Angora fire that, you know, an alien came in and just sort of zapped that house because none of the vegetation was involved. But really it was that embers penetrated the home either by the ventilation system, which we'll describe in a little bit more detail in a bit, or by landing on vegetation right next to the home that created an exposure to the home and direct flame contact to the home. So becoming ember aware is what we're going to talk a lot about in this webinar series. So I've got a few more slides here, and I just want to, you know, come back to this element of fire behavior and the topography, weather, and fuel element. And what element can you control? Well, you can, on the topography front, you can choose where you place your home. You can choose where you buy a home. But aside from that, you know, we're limited in a lot of confinement based on where our towns and our cities and our communities are. The weather, you know, it's really hard to choose your own weather. I know I always want to do that, but the fuel element is the part that each of us can control. And, you know, I just want to scale up to this idea that fuel is anything that will burn, you know, and most commonly we think about it as the trees, shrubs, and the grass, but it can be more broad than that. It can be the mulch we use to control moisture and weeds in our gardens. It can be our lawn furniture. It can be our cushions on our furniture as well. It can be elements of our fencing. I mean, look at this picture of the fencing here in Paradise. And it can be our decks, our play structures, our arbors, our trellises, our planter boxes, our stored wood piles. Fuel can also be your house. So thinking differently about what fuel is, that it's not just vegetation, is I think the art of getting into this topic here. So, you know, when it comes to this issue, what I often ask people is, what's been holding them back? You know, is it the neighbor's not on board, and so, you know, I'm overwhelmed by the neighbor's condition, or, you know, my home has too many problems, I don't even know where to start, or I need my privacy, or, you know, or I love my house just the way it is. Well, I guess I just encourage you to confront each of those issues and think about it. And ultimately, you can't affect your neighbors, but you can affect your own environment. So, you know, the small actions matter. And yes, this image here shows a number of issues, but I do think that most of them are manageable and achievable.